Once you take the tablet and dissolves into your stomach, it sends a signal that you took the tablet. So imagine the applications of that, the compliance, the insurance companies to know that the medicines that patients should take, they do take them. It is fascinating what happens in this field.
Catch up now with David Gillespie, who's the Regional Health Minister, joining us here in Sydney. Good to talk to you, David.
Great to be
pretty
back, Chris.
Exciting news about this new antiviral pill to tackle COVID-19. Australia's got an order in for a few hundred thousand of these. It's going to be particularly significant, the suggestion is, in regional areas where people might be have greater distances to hospitals.
Yeah, look, it is important to have both oral and intravenous treatments. There's various drugs that have been approved, new ones that have been developed overseas, and this latest molnirivabab is actually a treatment that reduces the chance of you getting sick enough to go to hospital by over 50%. So that's really going to take a lot of pressure off any hospital, but particularly regional hospitals who have got good capacity, but when you have a major outbreak, like we've seen before mass vaccination, it's really significant. So we are looking at many of these new drugs and this is now potentially available in Australia, assuming it gets through the rest of the registration process.
Are we expecting that these would be available only by prescription, or could people have some of these, particularly in remote areas, in case they do get infected?
No, I think it will be on prescription. I'm sure it'll be on prescription. The issue is we have got 300,000. Doses lined up, assuming registration goes ahead, and that will have to be held in key places to distribute where needed, when needed, as soon as possible. But the main thing is, what I've learnt from speaking to some of the regional health districts is, one in particular yesterday, they've had an outbreak of 260 cases, but only two people are sick enough to end up in hospital. So the vaccines are working. They modify the disease. There will be cases. All these states that are slow catching up on the vaccination, once they've got above that 80%, they should obviously keep vaccinating, but you won't see the numbers that you've seen in earlier outbreaks when we had low vaccination rates.
Did that raise the question of the role for these treatments? If the vaccination is doing that job of keeping the disease mild, when would you use the treatment? Immediately someone's infected even though they're vaccinated? Or is this perhaps something that we specially put aside for those who are unvaccinated?
Well, both. If you can still get the disease, but it's a modified illness when you're vaccinated. They're not 100% watertight, but they give your immune system the memory to make the antibodies to fight the illness, and that's what modifies it. But some of them break through and still get sick. You can treat them. People who aren't vaccinated and end up really symptomatic, obviously you get in early and you can reduce the chance of them ending up in hospital. So it'll be across the board. It'll be symptomatic people, obviously. And hopefully, if really high vaccination rates like we've got in New South Wales and the ACT and Victoria happen in South Australia, WA and Queensland, we won't see the hospital swamped. But we've got a great hospital system, we've got good vaccines, and now we've got both oral treatment and intravenous treatment to treat it if you do get sick.
And how far off before we're actually having this being administered in this country?
Well, it's been licensed in the UK. It is still going through assessment here, and I can't give you an exact time, but obviously the pressure to have something available is there. I think the TGA.
What sort of time frame we look at though, roughly? Certainly before next winter, which would be critical?
Oh yeah, well and truly by then. I'm thinking early in the new year, but look, I don't want to second guess the TGA. They have their processes and analysis of the data, which is, there's more coming through all the time. It will be available in the future if it passes all the regulatory hurdles that we demand in Australia to make sure the drugs are, one, are very effective, and two, they're safe to use.
Minister, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
Dr. David Gillespie there, the Minister for Regional Health.
In every job that must be done, there is an element of fun. You find the fun And snap, the job's a game. And every task you undertake becomes a piece of cake, a lark, a spree. It's very clear to see.
Who has learned some extraordinary detail on the recent illness of billionaire mining magnate Clive Palmer. Pete, take us through what you know here.
Well, I spoke to Clive Palmer earlier today and he says he nearly died from a double dose of pneumonia and the Delta strain of COVID, of course Delta being more aggressive than Omicron. Now, he was admitted to hospital on the Gold Coast on February 27 and he told me a team of specialists who treated former US President Donald Trump put him onto a United States trial which enabled him to use antiviral drugs that are not approved and not recommended in Australia by the Therapeutic Goods Administration. Now, this US-based team, some of whom had worked on former President Donald Trump's COVID case, they had these Zoom calls with Australian doctors to monitor his progress. Now, what he told me was this, Kieran: I would have died otherwise, without doubt, Mr. Palmer said. Now, two of the antiviral drugs included the controversial agents ivermectin and hydroxychloroquine, both of which are not approved and not recommended for use by the TGA in Australia. Now, Palmer said he signed himself out of the Gold Coast hospital that he was in after being told he'd be ventilated and put into ICU, and then he went home to undergo the alternative treatment. Extraordinary stuff, no doubt about it, Kieran. And look, he's a maverick in every sense of the word, and he's basically shunned conventional medicine and gone with this cocktail of antivirals.
Mm. And controversial experts as well, including one, I believe, Professor Tom Barodi.
Yeah, now, Professor Tom Barodi is a gastroenterologist. He was approached by senior staff in the Palmer camp, and Barodi was the guy who organised the US specialists to intervene. He's well known for developing alternative medicines for digestive diseases, but Palmer used his expertise in this case. Now, we know the advice from the government on this is very clear, Kieran. The best protection for COVID is vaccination and hospital treatment, and vaccines are very effective at preventing severe illness, hospitalisation and death if they catch COVID-19. But Palmer has, you know, he sings to his own tune, KG. Even when he's very, very sick, he made that very fateful decision to, you know, sign himself out. I understand it was a very robust conversation with medical specialists at Pindara Private Hospital. He actually had an ambulance on standby near his Sovereign Islands mansion if the antivirals didn't work. But what he said was, Kieran, the US specialists were very strong about not going onto a ventilator. And I've been told that without the antiviral intervention on that Sunday night, I would have likely have been dead within 5 hours.
And Palmer Gliso is unvaccinated. Is that still the case?
He's still unvaccinated and he'll remain unvaccinated. He says he's pro-choice. And of course, you better than anyone, Kieran, know his big political messaging, and you know, he's spending a fortune. I mean, he's expected to spend about $100 million on the federal campaign, and he's got endorsed candidates in all House of Representatives seats. He's also the endorsed Senate candidate for Queensland. He's now worth about $18 billion, according to the Australian newspaper. And I know Otagi have got, you know, some strong advice on this.
Who wants to know?
I am Henry the Red, Duke of Shale, Lord of the Northlands and Leader of its peoples.
Well, hello, Mr. Fancy Pants. I got news for you, pal. You ain't leading but two things right now, Jack and shit. And Jack left town.